Now is the time for true worshiping. And then we said, worship the worthy one. Amen. 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 Now we all know who the worthy one is. Yes. I don't know how to even say who it is, but you know, it begins with a J and ends with the S.
Hello.
Jesus. Amen. So what we want to do is just bring up the date from last week. Last week we said, you know, there are such worshipers that are not true. And so the things that they might do might not be true. So we looked at, you know, there are those that maybe come to church and they know it's the right thing to do, but they don't really come expecting change, expecting to hear a word that is going to change their lives or their heart, or maybe even convict them, because nobody likes to be convicted, amen? Nobody likes to be told they did wrong, amen? But then we said that there are those that maybe, you know, worshipers that are not true but do certain things that, like, pray openly because they want to be seen. Amen? Because they know how to pray. They got the lingo down. They can articulate it every word and give certain tones to make it even sound better than it really is. But they're only really impressing others but not really trying to impress God. Those are worshipers who do things that are not true. And then we said there are those who worship that really serve the Lord. And it could be anybody and anything, any service unto the Lord. But all of these things are good. Serving the Lord is good. Praying is good. Coming to church is good. If you're coming by faith, expecting to meet God here and expecting to glorify God, and everything that we do is giving our attention to God. Amen. That's when we are truly worshiping the Lord. Amen? We're directing our attention to one who is worthy.
Amen.
Amen? And that's what we want to look at today. The one who is worthy of our worship.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The one that, you know, saved you.
Hello.
The one that, you know, loves you.
Yeah.
The one that heals you. The one that, like, delivers you from a troubled mind, maybe. The one that knows all about you. Better than you know about yourself. And in spite of that, works all things together for the good of those who love the Lord and those who are the called. This is the one who's worthy, church. This is the one that we want to direct all of our worship to. Amen? Do y'all know?
Yes.
Y'all know. Okay. I just want to make sure y'all know. And if you know him, has he done anything for anybody in here that will cause you to say, thank you, Lord, to direct your attention to the one that has blessed you in some manner or one way or the other, amen, that you want to then direct all your adoration, all your attention, all your devotion, all your love. Just like the song said, wrap me in your arms, you want to wrap him in your arms. Close to you, he's saying, I want you to be drawn close to me.
Amen.
This is when you start to move from worship to true worship.
Wow.
Amen. Let me give you two things. I'm going to give you two statements. Amen.
Amen.
True worship happens with true conversion. True worship happens with true conversion. Y'all got that? That's when the heart has been regenerated. Turn with me, if you would, to Luke chapter 17. The book of Luke. Dr. Luke, they call him. Chapter 17. And we're going to read verses 1, I believe it is. Let me get there. Luke chapter 17. And we're going to read verse 11 down through 16. Luke chapter 17, verse 11, down through 16. And when you have to say amen?
Amen.
Now it happened, this is the 10 lepers that were cleansed, right? Now it happened as he went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria. Here's Samaria again, amen? And Galilee. Then as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers, who stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. They, the ten, all lifted up their voices, all ten, right? So when he saw them, he said to them, go show yourselves to the priests. And so it was that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, returned and with a loud voice glorified God and fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks.
Yes.
Now listen to this. He was a Samaritan.
Yeah.
Now why would the Bible want to make a point of saying he was a Samaritan?
Wow.
Because think about the 10 that were healed, yeah, but only one came back. Yeah. The one that came back was not of the covenant.
Right.
The one that came back was a Samaritan.
Yeah.
And remember, the Samaritans worship what they know, amen, on the mountain. Where they were, the Jacob's Well mountain, remember?
Yeah, right.
And they said the Jews worship in Jerusalem, amen?
Amen?
But the Samaritan was not of the covenant. That's why anything to do with Samaria or Samaritans, you know, they had the conflict with the Jews and the Samaritan people. Because the Jews, they understood, we have the covenant. We are the ones that are supposed to be blessed by the Lord. So for this Samaritan, outside of the Jews to come back, Jesus was like, wait a minute. What happened to the Jews that were supposed to have the covenant that should have recognized that it was me, the Messiah, who healed them? Shouldn't they have come back and gave me praise?
Wow.
But the Samaritan did something that we all want to take note. The Bible says he fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. Amen?
Amen.
Why? Because somewhere along the line, as he was traveling, going to show himself to the priest, when the Lord touched him, when the Lord healed him, something happened in his heart. Something moved him to turn around and come back and give thanks to the one who healed him. Amen? Now, one of the things I want you to know, this is the second point I want you to see, that true worshipers will always lead you to Christ. True worshipers will always lead you to Christ. See, those nine obviously was not true. Because not one of them came back to see Jesus. Not one of them directed their adoration, their thanks, to say, Lord, thank you. But true worshipers will always have you pointed in direction of the cross.
Amen.
And the direction of the Jesus, the Savior, the Lord, the God who delivers.
Amen.
And this Samaritan, like us, when God changed our heart, we turned from the world and we looked at Jesus.
Amen.
We turned from the sins of the world, amen,
amen,
and we looked at the righteousness that is in Christ Jesus. We began to what? Follow Christ. We, like the Samaritan, we came back because why? We want to worship the living God.
Amen.
We want to bow down to the one who's worthy of our bowing down to.
Amen.
See, anybody know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
Turn with me to John chapter 4. Let's go back there real quick. And when we look at verse 22, you remember the statement that Jesus says? He says, you worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. Isn't it interesting he didn't say, we know who we worship? He says, you worship what you, wait, let me go back. You worship what you do not know, as opposed to you worship who you do not know. He said, you worship what you don't do not know. Is Jesus a what? He's a who, isn't he? But see, what you do not know, remember the Samaritans only had the Pentateuchs. They only had the five books. So their knowledge of the Messiah is limited. So they only worship what they do not know. You see what I'm saying? Jesus says, but we and the Jews and now us, we worship what? The God who is the Messiah. Why? Because we worship in spirit and truth.
Amen.
You have to know him, but you can't know him apart from his word.
Amen.
The word of God is what allows us for God to give us a peek as of his character, as of how much he loves us, as of how much he gave his only begotten son. We start to learn about the nature of God, how holy he is, how angry he can get. Didn't we see in, I swore in my wrath that for 40 years I was grieved with that generation. Why? Because they were not true worshipers. Why? Because they had a form of godliness, but they denied the power thereof. They wanted God for what he could do. I need water, Lord. Give me something to drink. Otherwise, I'm going to start complaining. Okay, I'm hungry, Lord. Why'd you bring us out here? What, to die? In the wilderness? We've been better off back in Egypt. Oh, you got food? Okay, we got food. I'm a little wearied. You know, the Egyptians, they're coming after us. What about trusting in the Lord with all thy heart? What about, I know it doesn't make sense that you're standing before the Red Sea and it looks like you're between a rock and a hard place. It looks like you have no way out. But what about trusting in the God who delivered you to the Red Sea? What about the God who showed you all the plagues in Egypt that allowed you or caused Pharaoh to say, just get out of here. Not. Can I go now? Now, go. Leave us. Because we will be destroyed if you stay. As a matter of fact, take some gold with you. Take some clothing with you. Take whatever you want. What about that God? What about the remembering the God who saves? The God who delivers. And when you get to that place where you don't know what to do, and it looks like the obstacles, the door, it might be closed, why not just fall on your face before the Lord? Say, Father, I don't know where I'm going to go or how this thing's going to work out, but I'm going to trust you with all my heart. I'm going to bow down because this is the best position for me to be in.
Amen.
On my face, trusting with the Lord.
Amen.
If I'm on my face, bow before the Lord, do you really think God's going to let anything happen to me while we're worshiping?
Woo, thank you, Lord.
See, it's only when we get prideful and stand up and say, I can do this on my own. And God says, no, you can't. No, you can't. And if you want to, you're going to be just like those that wandered for 40 years when you could have been at the place of blessing in 11 days. Because that's all it would have taken. But the Bible says that God purposely took them around the mountain so that they wouldn't get caught up in the people that they're about to face and maybe be willing to run back to Egypt. Let's walk around for 40 years and see whether they, after I try them and after I test them, let's see whether they are really going to be worthy. Hello. See, we're talking about God is worthy. But see, your worthiness depends on whether you bow to him. Your worthiness of whether God will bring you through or not is whether you trust him. Your worthiness is all based on your relationship with him. Are you willing to worship the worthy one, or are you willing to take matters into your own hands and take your eyes off the worthy one and put it on something else and start worshiping something else? Remember in the Old Testament, we talked about what the translations meant. We said in the Old Testament, the translation for worship meant to bow down or to prostrate before the Lord and to serve the Lord. Amen? But in the New Testament, not only does it still mean to bow down and to still to prostrate oneself or to serve the Lord, but add to that, it means to sacrifice. Now think about this. In order to worship, you might have to sacrifice your time, your talent, which is your gift, your treasure, which is your money. He says, this is one way of showing whether you're worthy or not. Is if you're willing to sacrifice and do something that is going to bless me instead of the things that normally you would put in front of me that you wouldn't sacrifice. See, there's a lot of things that we might sacrifice other than, or sacrifice to, other than God. Second thing is reverence is what the translations in the New Testament means. The fear of the Lord, the deep respect that we have for the Lord. But see, you can again say there's a lot of other things, if you're not careful in what you worship, that could become your worship, your attention. Like, what else would you might give more respect to? Do you give your spouse, your children, your job, money, more respect? Like, you know, this is awesome. What's awesome? God? Yes.
Amen.
It should be yes.
Amen.
God is awesome.
Yes, He is.
Or is it, you know, my children, they did so good in school, or they did so good in sports, or whatever it is, that I just want to bless them because, and all of my attention right now is about them. No, you can praise your children, you can bless your children, as long as you know why your children are the way they are.
Yes.
It's because you've been praying for your children.
Yes.
It's because God's been answering prayer on behalf of your children so that things are working out. So you give them that little respect, but you direct the reverence and the fear of the Lord to God. Because He's the one that gave us life.
Yes.
He's the one that blessed our children to be where they are, and He can take it away.
Yep.
Just as easy as He gave.
That's right.
Number three, or number five, really, is worship means praise. Amen? Amen. So you know how we get our praise on.
Yes.
We really get our praise on. Well, that's an act of worship. And again, what do we praise outside of God? Is it football? See, praise is your exuberance. It's your excitement that you're giving attention to. And we know a lot of people will go to games and watch games on TV and start to shout. I mean, I shout myself. Amen? But I understand that that shouting is different than this shouting.
Yeah.
This shouting is because I'm asking to enjoy a game.
Yeah.
But if they lose or win, it doesn't make a difference to me.
Yeah.
Amen? But God, I will always praise.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
We will always direct our attention and our exuberance and our excitement and our joy because of what He is and who He is and what He's done in us and for us and through us. Amen?
Amen.
And then we have adoration.
Hallelujah.
I adore you, Lord.
Yeah.
This is all worship. This is all of what we're talking about worship. Think about bowing before the Lord. Think about serving the Lord. Think about praising the Lord. Think about giving reverence unto the Lord. Think about sacrificing unto the Lord. Think about, did I say reverence? I said reverence. And adoration. When you put all this together, and if all of it, if every one of these areas that I just mentioned is directed to Jesus, if all of them are going this way, you're truly worshiping God.
Amen.
That's when you are a true worshiper.
Amen.
Because then God looks down and sees that you're worthy.
Yeah.
Now He wants to bless you because when you bless Him, you can't outdo Him. Y'all know that.
Right.
If you bless Him, He's going to bless you back.
Ooh,
and when He bless you back, you can't help but give Him more praise.
Amen.
And more honor and more glory because you're so grateful and so excited and thankful.
That's right.
That you just got to say, Lord, hallelujah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Praise you, God.
Yeah.
You are so good to me.
Yeah.
That's when you really start to get excited and directed to the worthy one.
Yeah.
The one that's most worthy.
Yes.
Amen. Now, let me tell you this. God is not only deserving, but He desires true worship.
Amen.
Stay right here in chapter 4 of John, and look at right here in verse 23. It says, but the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship Him. Amen?
Amen.
Y'all get this? Now, I want you to really get this. God really, really desires our true worship. And we just talked about the six attributes, 1, 2, 3, 4, six attributes that is all worship. And if we do all of those things, then God is pleased. And that's when God says, this is what I've been desiring all this time. I've been desiring for you to sacrifice some of your time. I've been desiring you to have that fear of the Lord. Because
yeah.
The fear of the Lord keeps you from sinning.
Right.
See, the fear of the Lord is not just respect. The fear of the Lord is understanding that God holds your breath in your in his hands. And that he does not like sin. And when you step out and you violate his law on purpose, even without look, if you have fear of the Lord, then what happens is when you either are about to sin or you sin, oh Lord, I'm sorry. You have that immediate, forgive me, Lord. Because you recognize you've been disappointed our God, our loving God, who died on the cross so that we could have the power not to sin. So you don't have to. I mean, we're in the flesh, so we tend to every so often stumble or fall into it, but we don't have to. And if you notice, if you think about your life, there are some sins that you just don't have, they have no power over you. They can tempt you with sin, a certain sin that you used to fall into,
right.
Don't fall into anymore. You have power now to resist.
Yeah.
But then there's some other sins that we're still not quite there yet, that we still struggle with. And the key word is struggle. It's not, oh, I just love this sin. I'm just going to continue in this. I know I've been saved, but God's grace will cover me. No, thou shalt not use the grace of God in vain. So I will not continue to sin on purpose. Amen? But now, the Father is seeking and desires true worship. Let me give you some analogies. Amen? I thought this was interesting because you look at how the Father in heaven is and how fathers on earth are.
Right.
And I'm not talking about the fathers that are in the homes. I'm talking about the fathers that are not in the homes. Because, see, if God is our Father and you're now just born into a relationship with God, but you're not trying to grow in God, you're not trying to seek God, you're not trying to get to know God, Father, I'm saying, amen? Mm-hmm. Well, let's take that analogy and let's look at the world's analogy with the father who now leaves their son or daughter, amen? Now, check this out. The Father, God, is always seeking to build a relationship with their children. Mm-hmm. That's why he says the Father is seeking such to worship him.
Right.
But in the kingdom, the way we first are born into the kingdom, we're not necessarily seeking to build our relationship with him as much as he is with us. Because if we were, then every moment of the day, every opportunity we have, we would be on our faces. We would be praying. We would be saying, Lord, I want you to help me grow. You'd be saying things that is going to allow the Spirit of God to transform us to be more like him. But we don't do that. What we do is we do give him his praise, give him his due. Amen? But then we have the world we have to deal with. And the world will be pulling on you. And trying to get you to do things that is of the world. And we conflict it sometimes. God is never conflicted. God the Father always is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. He is always trying to woo us to come closer, come closer, come closer. We, on the other hand, will come as close as we want to get. Come on now. Tell the truth. We should want to be the way he wants and get as close as we can get. That's where we're getting to, true worship. When we get to the point where our attitude is, I want so much more of you, Lord, nothing in this world matters. Nothing in this world matters. And because of that, now I'm going to focus when I walk out of here. I'm going to focus, just reflect a little bit. I'm going to think about a little bit more than I used to do. And I'm going somewhere a little later, so stay with me on that. But now, look at the Father, how he tries, never changes, always trying to woo us. But look at the children of a natural family of a father who's left. It's not the father that's trying to get to the son or the daughter. It's the son or the daughter that misses their father and is always trying to get back the father into their lives. Look at this. The Father in heaven gives grace in spite of us. We can act a fool, amen, and he loves us in spite of us.
Hallelujah.
Look at the children. The children in a natural When the father's gone, don't make a difference. That child will excuse that parent because they just want to be with their father.
Yeah.
That father can treat them bad, can walk out, and the child will still want their father to be in their lives. It's the opposite. The world is the opposite of the spiritual kingdom.
Yeah.
The father in heaven is always one.
Yeah.
It's the children that is one the father.
Yeah. Yeah.
In the natural world. It's grace that God the Father gives the children, but it's the children that give grace to the parents.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that something?
Yeah. Yeah.
Because that's how it's twisted, but that's how the world is. God is always opposite of the world.
Yeah.
And that's something we need to learn and grow in. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Let me tell you, we were watching a movie last night. It was called Six Below. And it was just real quick, it was about this guy who grew up and he was addicted to meth. But as a child, his father was constantly driving him to be the best that he could be in hockey. And he actually grew up and became a good hockey player and was really gonna just excel in that. But he had an attitude. And the coach made him mad one time and he got to fighting and he just threw it all away. And then his father left. Well, actually his father left him when he was a kid. But he never forgot anything. He never forgot how the father was. He never forgot the words that the father kept telling him, you know, about you can do it. Don't give up. Get up off the ice, because he had fell on the ice one time. And he never forgot that. And so when he got out in Six Below, the movie is about him being up in someplace in the mountains. It's like a ski resort.
Yeah.
And he's a snowboarder. And, you know, he's trying to fight or kick the habit of meth. And so every day he's like 7 days, 6 days down to one day. But one time he went out to go in the mountain and he ended up getting lost out there because it was a big storm. And he had to survive. And there was wolves out there. I mean, days went by and he's out there by himself. And the wolves he's dealing with the wolves and whatnot and the falling in the ice. And I mean, a bunch of things, right? And the only thing that kept him going was him kept remembering what his father had said to him about don't give up. The coach is saying don't give up. Everybody talking about how he was and you threw this away. You know, you quit. And so we said in his mind means don't quit. And then, you know, now I'm not gonna be a quitter.
Okay.
And so he ended up making it through and he got through and they came and got him. But the thing I wanted to share with you was the fact that he started reflecting back about all the words.
Wow.
Tell me children don't remember stuff. Then he started reflecting back everything as he was a child that his father told him. And even though his father left him, he never forgot those words about don't give up, don't quit. He says, you're, whatever his last name is, you're so-and-so, we don't quit.
Wow.
And right when he was about to die, several times he had that come to his mind. And he would muster up enough strength to be able to get to where he's going, amen? So what are we saying about now is the time for true worshiping? And how do we do this? You ready for your 3 points?
Amen.
Number one, get to know God more by His Word. Get to know God by His Word. And when you get there, turn with me to Romans chapter 10, verse 2. Or you can write it down and go there later. Romans chapter 10. Verse 2, and it's get to know God more by His Word. Because we need more of God.
Amen.
See, He's more than enough for us,
yeah.
But we need more of Him.
Amen.
Amen. Amen? And verse 2 reads like this. Actually, let's read verses 1 and 2. It's Paul, and he says, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they may be saved. But he says, for I bear them witness that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. Not according to knowledge. Not worshiping in spirit and truth. See, they got the zeal. They got the feeling. They moved. Amen? But they don't have the knowledge. And he says, you need to understand the truth if you're going to worship God in spirit and truth. It's not one moment I'm going to worship Him in the spirit and just get caught up in the spirit. And then the next moment, I'm going to pray and I'm going to be praying in the spirit. and I'm going to be speaking the word of God. No, it's together. If you're praying in the spirit with the word of God, you're truly worshiping God. Because you can't worship God without the word of God. You can't know God without his word. So how are you going to worship somebody you don't know? That's why Jesus told the Samaritan woman, you worship what you don't know. You're limited, is what he was saying. You only worshiping the fact that Jacob built a well here on this mountain, and Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Moses built an altar here. And you know that because of the first five books of the Bible. Yep. But what about, for unto us a child is born, a son is given, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father.
Yes.
What about Psalms when he talks about, and he's going to be pierced in the spirit in the side, and he's going to be nailed, his nails going to be in his hands, he got to hang on the cross.
Wow.
What about the Redeemer that's coming?
Yes.
Do you even know about the Redeemer?
My God.
You heard about a Messiah, because obviously you said the Messiah is coming, but you don't know he's going to be coming as a Jew? You didn't know that. He said, for salvation is of the Jews.
Yep.
Jesus showed up, and she didn't recognize him because she wasn't expecting a Jew.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, get to know God more by his word. Amen?
Amen.
Turn with me to number two, Psalm 42. We're going to start there. But number two is, how do we get to the place of true worshiping? This is key now. Number two is going to be really key. It's prepare for corporate worship through private worship. Prepare for corporate worship. Like prepare when you come to church. You should already have worship down because you have a private worship moment. So prepare for corporate worship through private worship. Amen?
Amen. Amen?
Psalms 42, it starts off like this. This was one of the ones that I truly thought was where you want to be. In Psalms 42, it starts off, as a deer pants for the water brooks, so pants my soul for you, O God. You see that? As a, you know, the deer, when he's thirsty, I got some water. And I'm really, really thirsty for the water. Well, he says, my soul thirsts for God, for the living God. And he says, when shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my food day and night, while they continually say to me, they're mocking him, where is your God? He says, when I remember these things, I pour out my soul within me. For I used to go with the multitude. I went with them to the house of God with the voice of joy and praise, with the multitude that kept a pilgrim feast. Now stop right there. Because what he said is, I used to go to church. And when I went there with a soul that was thirsty. A soul that pants like a deer panting for water. My soul was panting. I couldn't wait to get into the household of faith. I couldn't wait to get among the brothers and sisters in corporate worship. Because it's something about when we come together, remember, in unity and corporate worship, when we all praising God, when we all bow down before God, when we all have that adoration, amen? When we all have that attitude of, I'm going to sacrifice some time. I'm not going to be looking at my watch to hurry up and get out of here.
Right.
Amen. I'm going to enjoy the moment that I have with the Lord.
Amen.
He says here, prepare for corporate worship through private worship. I'm going to tell you how to do that in a minute. This was just to tell you what the effects of it is. But we got to look at Psalm first chapter 5, verse 1. Psalm chapter 5, verse 1. And it says, through 3, it says, give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my meditation. Give heed to the voice of my cry, my King and my God. For to you I will pray. For my voice you shall hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning I will direct it to you, and I will look up. When you open your eyes in the morning, this is your first opportunity for private worship. This is your first opportunity to look up. Even before you step out of the bed, just open your eyes and just meditate. Just think about what the Lord has done. The fact that He opened your eyes. Think about the fact that you got the activity of your limbs. Think about the fact that He provided all that you need. You got a bed to lie in. You got shelter over you. You got food in the cupboard.
Yes, yes, yes.
Clothes on your back. You got transportation. You got money in the bank. Think about all that God has done before you even get out of the bed. Now He's saying, you know, about all that. I'm just saying, give me some examples. I'm just saying that this is your private worship. And it starts when you open your eyes in the morning. Your meditation will cause you to worship. One of the things I was sitting there thinking about when we was praising God a little while ago, and it's not with worship here, but it's worship there. It's not what I was talking about here, but it's how we praise God, which is worship. And I thought about it, and I thought, you know how we dance and we act a fool and just enjoy that, right? You know what? You can't do that if you're angry. You ever try to dance? You ever try to dance when you're angry? Man, you might be able to sing. You might be able to sing if you're angry. For a minute, you'll come out of it, but you can maybe start off if you're carrying something. You might be able to, but you can't get out there and get to dancing if you're angry.
Right.
Because then you don't start moving to dance until you're excited. Something moves in you. You might sing, but then that singing turns to dancing. The next thing you know, you're excited. Praise.
Hallelujah.
Worship.
Yep.
Amen.
But you're moved. What I'm saying is you're moved. Amen?
Amen.
Turn with me to number 3. And we're going to wrap it up here. Number 3. Don't compromise worship of the worthy one.
Amen.
Don't compromise your worship of the worthy one for anything. Remember, worship is I'm directing my attention to whatever thing it is, and I'm giving that the most important part of my attention, you know, my mind, my soul, and my body, whatever it is at that moment, whatever I'm doing, if I'm giving that more than I'm giving God, then that's who you're worshiping, or that's what you're worshiping, whatever it is in that case.
Right.
Turn with me to 2 Kings. This is King of Assyria, but you got to look at the subtitle again. Assyria resettles Samaria. If you want to know where Samaria came from and how this all came to be, it's right here. We're going to read verses 12. I didn't give you the verse. Verse 24. I'm sorry.
What chapter?
Chapter. Oh, I didn't give you chapter. Yeah. Y'all supposed to read me. You supposed to discern. Where is he going with this? Chapter 17, amen? Chapter 17 of 2 Kings, chapter 17, and we're going to pick up in verse 24. And it's under the heading, we're saying, don't compromise worship of the worthy one, amen? And we're going to read verses 24 through 29, then we're going to read 33 through 36. Then, are you all there?
Yes.
All right. Then the king of Assyria brought people from Babylon, Ava, Hamath, and from Sepharvaim, and placed them in the cities of Samaria instead of the children of Israel. Y'all see this? Now you see why the Jews are over one place and you got Samaritans over in another place. And they took possession of Samaria and dwelled in it in the cities. Now, before I could even go any further, I was talking to a good friend of mine, and he shared with me that Israel was in Samaria, but then you got these that resettled those that are not of the covenant, that are all mixed in with Samaria.
Okay.
So what you got is the Samaritans and these other good brothers, Hamath, Ava, Cutha, that came from Babylon, amen? Mm-hmm. And they began to intermingle and intermarry one with another. And so now you're talking about not having the pure lineage of the Jewish.
Yeah.
covenant.
Yes.
Then you got Samaria and the whole mixed breed. Amen? Amen. So, but it goes on. It says in verse 25, and it was so at the beginning of their dwelling there, that they did not fear the Lord. Therefore, the Lord sent lions among them, which killed some of them. So they spoke to the king of Assyria, saying, the nations whom you have removed and placed in the cities of Samaria do not know the rituals of the God of the land. Therefore, he, God, has sent lions among them, and indeed, they are killing them because they do not know the rituals of the God of the land. Amen? Now go down to, we're going to keep going. Then the king of Assyria commanded, saying, send there one of the priests whom you brought from there. Let him go and dwell there, and let him teach them the rituals of the God of the land. Then one of the priests whom they, verse 29, had carried away from Samaria came and dwelt in Bethel and taught them how they should fear the Lord. Amen? So they took the priest, they took this one priest that was of God, brought him into Samaria so that they can teach them how to do the rituals. Amen? But one of the things you're going to see in verse 33, they feared the Lord, yet served their own gods. You see that?
Yeah.
According to the rituals of the nations from among whom they were carried away. To this day, they continue practicing the former rituals. They do not fear the Lord. They do not fear the Lord. They do not fear the Lord. Right? Nor do they follow their statutes or their ordinances or the law and commandment which the Lord had commanded the children of Jacob, whom he named in Israel. Now here's the key. With whom, verse 35, the Lord had made a covenant and charged them, saying, you shall not fear them, you shall not fear other gods, or bow down to them, nor serve them, nor sacrifice to them. But the Lord who brought you up from the land of Egypt and with great power and an outstretched arm, him you shall fear,
amen,
him you shall worship, and to him you shall offer sacrifice.
Amen.
We are not to compromise the worthiness of the one who is worthy. We're not to compromise who we worship.
Amen.
Don't allow anybody to take your attention off of God. You know how many people I've heard talk about, you know, I believe in God through Jesus, but I also believe in Buddha. I also believe in Muhammad. You know, who's to say that your God is the right God? Well, if you're saying that this God is the right God, and that God is the right God, and this God is the right God, then really it nullifies any of them to being the only God.
Right.
But we know there's but one.
Amen.
We know that there's only one true and living Savior.
Amen.
And him we will not compromise.
Amen.
Amen. And him we will stand victorious.
Amen.
Amen. Stand secure, anchored in Jesus, on the foundation that he has laid, that all we're doing is building on the foundation, but we're careful how we're building on that foundation. Amen.
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 Amen. That's right.
Uh-huh.
Yep.
The one that we worship.
Yeah.
Is the one that we sacrifice our time.
Thank you.
The one that we're going to serve willingly and by faith.
Thank you.
The one that we're going to praise.
Yes.
And direct all our excitement and our exuberance and our attention to. The one that we adore.
Yes.
The one that we're going to bow down to.
Amen.
This is the one that is worthy. And this is the one that we give praise to. And honor and glory and majesty and all that he is worth. Amen?
Amen.
For there is but one God. Amen? And so what do we say? Now is the time for true worshiping. Worship the worthy one. Amen? Amen. Come on to God.